Thanks for the introduction, and I'm quite excited to be here with you all. I think certainly at the outset, one of the things that that's going to run through this presentation is really the idea that international cooperation is essential to addressing the climate crisis. And the presentation will particularly focus on that cooperation at the multinational level, at sort of the cooperation between countries, between national governments. And so certainly there are a lot of other elements to international climate cooperation and engagement and working across countries, whether it be civil society or business. But a lot of this presentation will focus on what is happening at that the international level between between countries, and so I'm hoping to speak for 30-35, no more than 40 minutes if I'm running very late, and then really a chance at the last part of the session to answer some questions and also have a discussion with you. And so I want to, here's the sort of, I think I've organized the presentation in three sort of buckets. I think the first will be a brief overview of the international climate process. I think it's, I won't dwell too much on sort of the history of this process, but I think it is really important to understand how cooperation between countries has changed and evolved over time. And I think that's really important to understanding the current approach and the way countries are currently working together. Next will be an overview of the Paris Agreement, which is the international agreement countries adopted in 2015, and which really sets the current framework for international climate action. And so I'll spend some time sort of an overview of that. And then the third bucket will be a look at ways that some of the sort of exciting cooperation, some of the exciting elements that climate action is moving forward at the international level, as well as some ways to support and engage that process. So for the first bucket, we'll start with a brief history of the UN climate process. And apologies, you'll see some acronyms on the slides. The one you'll see most frequently is this UNFCCC or the UNFCCC, which stands for the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. I will try to limit my use of the acronym, but please forgive me as it's become a little ingrained. But the UNFCCC, that framework convention, was the first international treaty adopted under the UN, specifically focused on addressing climate change. In the late 80s, the UN General Assembly nations realized that climate change was an issue, was a problem, and that they needed to develop a way forward, a treaty, an international agreement on international cooperation to address climate change. So the first years of the 90s, countries entered into negotiations on developing this treaty. And ultimately, they were able to agree on this, what we call the Framework Convention, which is the international treaty in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. There was a conference, a large conference, which is known as the Rio Earth Summit, that was held in June of 92. Where countries came together to agree on this treaty, as well as two other treaties, which are focused on desertification and biological diversity. But the one on climate change is known as the United Nations Framework Convention. And then a few years later, in 1995, after enough countries had signed on to the treaty, we have the first of the what are known as COPs, the conferences of the parties, which are the meetings where the countries that have signed on to the treaty gather. And so these conferences are held annually. And I know you had a session a few months ago on the most recent one, which was held in November of last year in Glasgow. So that first conference was held in 1995 in Berlin. And at that conference, countries realized that the treaty they had adopted to was useful, but it didn't outline some of the operational details. It didn't sort of detail exactly how they were going to reach their objective to address climate change. And so they began a period of negotiations, which concluded in 1997 in Japan, and where they adopted another treaty, another agreement, which is known as the Kyoto Protocol. And the Kyoto Protocol set forward the framework, the strategy for international cooperation on climate change. It had 192 countries sign on out of the 197 who had adopted the framework convention a few years earlier. And it outlined specific emissions reduction targets for developed countries that they would achieve over the next 15 years. So it set very specific targets to reduce emissions X percent from previous levels, and those were to be achieved over the next 15 years or so. Moving forward in the process, most notably the United States never joined the Kyoto Protocol, and there were a couple of other countries that had been very hesitant about the Kyoto Protocol and its approach, most notably that the protocol, that agreement focused primarily and solely on action from, at that time, developed country parties. And many were realizing that the economies of China, Brazil, South Africa, India, et cetera, were growing and would soon be contributing significant carbon pollution. And so there was a push to sort of move past the Kyoto Protocol and adopt a new treaty. And the plan was to agree on a new treaty in Copenhagen at the conference that was held in Copenhagen in 2009. Due to a number of factors, countries weren't able to agree. At the time, it was seen as a big mistake, a big problem that countries weren't able to agree on a new treaty in Copenhagen. And there were a lot of questions about the future of international cooperation on climate change. Moving forward a few years later, following Copenhagen, countries really regrouped and came forward and realized we needed to find a new approach. We needed to agree on a new treaty to address climate change. And so they eventually came forward and were able to do so in 2015 in Paris with what we now know as the Paris Agreement, which I'll detail in a little bit more detail. But that is the framework now that countries are really using to guide their cooperation and their efforts on climate change. And then upcoming in November of this year, we have the 27th Conference of the Parties, COP27, which will be held in Egypt and is the next step in this UN climate process. I mentioned that the United States never joined the Kyoto Protocol. It was never ratified by the United States Senate. And I wanted to just share something at the time, which really set the tone. There was a resolution in the United States Senate known as the Byrd-Hagel Resolution after those two senators, which passed unanimously 95 to zero. And essentially said that it was the position of the United States Senate that the United States would not join any treaty, any international effort that mandated or set forward commitments to reduce emissions from developed countries without also doing so from developing country parties. And that was really the approach that had been taken up to that time, that was the approach that was enshrined in the Kyoto Protocol, that developed country parties, because the developed countries, because they had much more history, they had been releasing greenhouse gas pollution for longer, they had historically been greater contributors to the problem of climate change, that they would take the lead, that they would be most responsible for reducing emissions. And the United States Senate said, we won't sign on to that unless there are also requirements here for developing countries. So I think that's sort of a quick history, a quick summary of where we are and how the process, how international cooperation has evolved. I'm certainly happy to spend more time discussing that, but I wanted to get to what I think in many ways is a major landmark moment in December of 2015. Countries came to Paris, France, looking to agree on a new agreement, on a new treaty, and they were able to do so, which was a major achievement. And the Paris Agreement sets out a number of key different outcomes. There are a few here in this graphic. First, the Paris Agreement sets out three long-term goals. The first is to limit temperature rise to well below 2 degrees Celsius and to pursue efforts to limit that rise to 1.5 degrees. Another long-term goal is on supporting adaptation and ensuring communities globally are able to be resilient to climate changes. And then the third is really transitioning the global financial flows from both from the private sector, from investors, from businesses, as well as from governments to really support low carbon development and clean development. So those are the three major goals, the three long-term goals of the Paris Agreement. And in order to achieve those goals, the Paris Agreement sets out this process where countries come forward every 5 years to strengthen their climate actions. So they will review their efforts, and then every 5 years they will present new climate action plans, new pledges, new targets that they would then seek to achieve. And build, and so that these actions and these efforts build upon each other over time, so that by mid-century, by 2050, globally, nations are on track to having what's known as net zero emissions, essentially for all the emissions that are released into the atmosphere through trees, landscapes, etc. Remove so that there's that balance of emissions. And so the plan is every 5 years to strengthen those efforts towards mid-century. The Paris Agreement also sets forward really enhanced transparency measures. So that way countries are required to report on what they are doing. They share information about their actions, what they have done, whether they've achieved their targets, and really builds on some of the previous transparency elements. So that really all countries, all stakeholders will be able to really understand how they are each performing, but also to build trust that it's not, I'm not going to take action because you aren't, or you're afraid to take action because you don't know if I really am. It's through sort of this transparency process that countries know that they are each taking action, and that allows them to move forward together. Another two important elements of the Paris Agreement is really adaptation and enhancing adaptation to support those most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, as well as providing financial support for countries, both to respond to climate impacts, to adapt, but also provide funds so that countries are able to implement lower polluting projects or support their development, funds to transition from coal to solar, for example. And as I was talking a bit about this this 5-year cycle where countries come forward. They present new climate targets, new pledges every 5 years. This is a graphic that that we've developed, and we sort of like to think of it as an arc of ambition. You know, those targets aren't are certainly not enough to get us to the end objective, but the idea is that in 5 years, countries come forward, present new targets. Those build upon what we already have, and then 5 years later, those continue to build upon what we already have, really until we reach, until we are in a position that we are reaching and meeting the long-term goals of the Paris Agreement. So you'll see in 2020, you have communicate these new, what are known as nationally determined contributions, NDCs, which is sort of the legalese, the negotiation, but essentially these climate pledges, these climate targets, that's what we refer to as NDCs. So you see in 2020, countries, 2021, the last few years, countries have come forward with new climate pledges, climate plans. In 2025, they are set to do so again in 2030, and so on. And in between those moments, every 5 years, we have what is known, the Paris Agreement sets out what is known as the global stocktake, which is a process that will take place every 5 years. The first one is just now beginning and will end next year in 2023. The next one will end in 2028. And the purpose of these stock-taking exercises, it's sort of like your visit to the doctor, your checkup every 5 years. How are you doing? Where do we stand collectively in terms of progress towards our towards the Paris Agreement's long-term goals? So countries will put forward their climate plans. They will go through this checkup, this stock-taking exercise. They will use that to inform their next round of plans. And so on. And so that's really building upon each to reach until we reach the long-term goals. And another little graphic that we've developed that I think essentially aims to tell the same type of story. We have this cycle where countries are planning. That's they're developing their climate plans. They're coming up with those targets. They're doing those exercises, thinking about what can we achieve in the next 10 years? What can we achieve over the short term, the medium term, the long term? Then obviously implementing those efforts, closing coal-fired plants, building wind farms, solar farms, expanding the use of public transport or electrification of vehicles or whatnot, and implementing all of those climate actions. And then the last sort of piece of this cycle is really reviewing those actions. Have we done what we've wanted to? Have we met our targets? Have we fulfilled our pledges, both individually, but also sort of individually as a nation, as a country? Where do we stand on what we've set out to do? But then also as part of that global stock take I mentioned, where do we stand collectively in terms of progress towards the Paris Agreement goals, and how can we use that to inform our next plan, our next targets, or in the lingo, the NDCs, those national climate plans. So this is really the theory behind the framework behind the Paris Agreement. And previously, as I was talking a bit about this, about the history and the U.S. Role in the Kyoto Protocol, in the Kyoto Protocol, you had developed countries at the time who had these commitments. And the thing about the Paris Agreement that really changed is it was for all countries. There wasn't this divide where developed countries would be on the hook for implementing efforts, reducing their emissions. But now all countries are set to put forward their plans, reduce their emissions, adapt to climate change, and enhance those efforts over time. And so it's this, what's evolved from a top-down system where countries were told, developed countries were told, you are going to reduce your emissions by this much, by this date. And we now have a bottom-up system, international system of cooperation, where countries are coming forward with their own plans. They're deciding what they can take on themselves. They are then held accountable. They are then required to be transparent about their efforts, how they have done, and then really build on and improve and enhance those efforts over time. And so that's a major shift in the international approach to climate change, and really one of the big breakthroughs of the Paris Agreement. I want to spend just a few minutes talking about the latest climate conference, the latest COP, which took place in November in Glasgow, and share a few thoughts on sort of the current state of international cooperation through the COPs. As I've mentioned, these take place annually, except for in 2020, they have, because of the pandemic, they have otherwise taken place annually since 1995. And the host of these conferences rotates every year among five different UN regional groups. So last year, the UK was the host of the conference as sort of a Western Europe and North America regional grouping. The regional group for this the hosting for this year is Africa. So the conference will be held in Egypt in November. Next year, the host is in the Asia Pacific region and will be held in the United Arab Emirates. So there's this regional rotation among hosts. But the most recent conference was held in Glasgow in the UK a few months ago. And I wanted to just start and share some headlines. And I have this quote at the top from my boss, who led our climate program, our Helen Mountford, who led our climate and economics center, or our climate and economics work over the last seven years. And I think it speaks to really some of the dynamics you see at play in the international climate space and during these climate conferences. And I think that's really that there are two elements that we're holding two different truths at the same time. The first is that we have made probably more progress than maybe could have been imagined, I think especially around 2009 and some of the perceived disaster of the conference in that year in Copenhagen. And we've made some more progress even than a few years ago could have been imagined. But that's also still really nowhere near enough to achieve the Paris Agreement's long-term goals, the long-term sort of vision and objective for the UN climate process. And so I think you see some of this reflected in some of these sort of headlines I've included screenshots, little snippets from, I think in, the CNN headline there in the top left, we had a historic reference to fossil fuels. The UN climate process included coal, specific reference to coal and fossil fuels in the decision, in the negotiations, in the agreed language, and the sort of the agreed multilateral process that was a big breakthrough in some ways. But including language on paper isn't in and of itself enough to meet the urgency of the crisis, and really a need to deliver climate action still remains. So really, from COP26, from the most recent conference, there was a range of progress, but again, we must celebrate that progress, but we also must recognize and hold that there's still a lot more to do. So from our perspective, from the World Resources Institute, there were four main questions we laid out at the beginning of the conference. And you see these here listed on the screen, to really think about what is the current state of climate cooperation between countries. First, the cycle where countries come forward with their climate targets, their pledges. Will they pledge significant action by 2030? And will those pledges put us on a pathway to limiting warming to 1.5 degrees? Or are we still on a pathway for warming that's much above 2 degrees, that's closer to 3 degrees? And so I mentioned that 2020 moment because of the pandemic. A few countries took them until 2021 and haven't and are still putting forward their next round of climate pledges and climate plans. And so we saw a number of those come in. Countries share those ahead of the conference in Glasgow. And ultimately, they show that we are sort of limiting that gap between where we were and 2 degrees, but we're still not quite yet to 2 degrees. We're still not quite, the current pledges don't yet reflect a pathway to 2 degrees and certainly don't reflect a pathway to 1.5 degrees. The pledges that countries put forward ahead of the conference still only have us maybe around 2.5 degrees Celsius increase. And so the next question is then, can they enhance those? Can next time in 2025 for this next round of pledges, will they come forward with more ambitious action? Will they come forward with deeper emissions cuts? The second is a question around finance and support. And these are important topics, especially to many developing country parties, developing countries who, need finance to transition their utilities or their energy system and really transform from fossil fuels to renewable energy, for example. In 2009, I mentioned the conference in Copenhagen. One of sort of the last minute things to come out of that conference was that developed countries agreed that by 2020, they would provide and mobilize and help mobilize $100 billion a year to developing countries. And so the plan was, as of a few years ago, every year, developed countries would be supporting developing countries to the tune of $100 billion a year. And it's quite clear that that target was not met, that developed countries have not done their job in terms of providing and helping mobilize that scale of finance for developing countries. And so questions about the conference were, will developed countries finally step up to help provide the finance that's needed for this transition? And we're still not quite there yet. Countries recognized they have more to do. They expect to meet the $100 billion target in the next few years. But at the COP and at the conference in Glasgow, they agreed they would also double the amount of money they provide to support adaptation efforts. The third question, will negotiators agree to rules? So in 2015, countries agreed on the Paris Agreement, but there were still sort of a lot of rules, a lot of operational details that countries had to negotiate, had to work together to develop. To really implement the Paris Agreement. So to use an example in terms of at least the US policymaking process, right? Congress passes a bill, but then it is up to the executive agencies to sort of write the rules, write the regulations. So in this case, that bill, that law was passed in 2015 in terms of the Paris Agreement. But then countries, there isn't sort of an executive branch to develop the regulations. So over the last few years, countries have had to do that to work on many of those pieces to really agree and finalize some of those rules, regulations that set out the Paris Agreement. And so in Glasgow at the conference, they were able to finalize that work. And then the fourth piece here is really questions about large systems change, large transformations. Will countries announce new partnerships? Will there be new partnerships and efforts that really drive some transformational changes on the ground in terms of action? And so we saw a large number of countries come forward as part of what's called the Global Methane Pledge, which was an effort spearheaded by the US and the EU originally to reduce methane emissions by 30% by 2030. And so these types of other breakthroughs, other big efforts and initiatives to really drive change. So this was sort of the four things, a few buckets that we were watching heading into the conference and then coming out of the conference. And then my last section here, hopefully I will conclude this in about 5 minutes and then or so and get to some of the questions and discussion. Really some of the positive momentum. Where do we see progress? Where is this international climate cooperation showing signs of progress and positive momentum forward? So this is, I wanted to share this graphic. Essentially, I mentioned these national climate commitments, pledges, targets, plans, which we refer to as NDCs. And by 2020, 2021, many countries were coming forward with new pledges, these new plans to show how sort of at the domestic national level, they were committed to reducing emissions. And so we have this graph where which shows some of the countries that have come forward with these new plans. And in blue, you see those countries that came forward with new plans that actually were enhanced, which reduced their emissions further than they had previously pledged. And in the yellow, you see some countries whose new plans don't necessarily reduce emissions further than they had been previously planned. I think most notably Brazil, Australia, Mexico, the new plans from them don't set out more ambitious targets, whereas the US has set out a new ambitious target, the EU, China, Chile, Canada, for example, have all come forward with new plans, new targets that really reduce their emissions. And so this is part of that cycle I was mentioning earlier. And so in 5 years, we'll have another version of this map, which shows again those countries which have come forward with new and enhanced plans. Similarly, the Paris Agreement also asks countries to present what we often refer to as long-term strategies or to communicate net zero targets. Again, essentially this is a target, a plan to meet where your emissions are equal to, or your emissions into the atmosphere, your pollution into the atmosphere is equaled, is balanced out by sort of the especially with CO2, the assumption of that pollution by trees, for example. And so you see a map of some of those countries that have put forward these net zero targets, either in law or in a policy document, or even just in a political pledge, and how countries globally are thinking about setting forward these ambitious targets. I mentioned questions. I think one of the big questions is certainly, are we on track for that Paris Agreement long-term goal of reaching 1.5 degrees? And this was a graphic that was developed by a British news organization known as called Carbon Brief. And essentially they've taken some of the assessments about the temperature trajectories from these climate plans and sort of mapped them out. So on the left in the red, orange, and yellow, you see sort of the projection, if countries meet their 2030 commitments, does that put it, what sort of temperature pathway does that put us on? And so a few years ago in 2020, we were on maybe a 2.6 degrees Celsius pathway. Ahead of the conference in Glasgow, maybe we had improved that to about 2.4 degrees. And then with some of the announcements in Glasgow, maybe we've improved that a little bit further to a trajectory to about 2.3 degrees. And so that's if we're looking sort of over the next 10 years, what countries and others have committed to do, pledged to do, that's sort of the trajectory we are placing ourselves on. And then if we were to look sort of thinking even further out to some of the net zero promises plans, which Many are around 2050, there's some a few years later. But sort of where, if we fully achieve those targets, what trajectory does that put us on? And ahead of the conference in Glasgow, those probably got us to about a 2-degree trajectory. And with some of the announcements from Glasgow, we've improved that a little bit. And so I've gotten us to maybe a 1.8-degree Celsius trajectory. So obviously the question now is we have some of these ambitious plans that seek to lower our temperature pathway. But how do we achieve them? Can and will countries achieve them? And what does cooperation on that look like? I want to mention just a few additional, I think, important announcements that emerged from the conference that really speak to achieving some of these targets. The first I already mentioned, the Global Methane Pledge, which I forget how many countries, I think it's over 100 countries now have signed on, really to achieve collectively a 30% reduction in methane emissions by 2030. And methane is a super potent greenhouse gas. And so the ability to reduce those emissions goes a long way in terms of helping us achieve our climate, our temperature targets. Many private investors came together, the business sector came together through what's known as the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero and pledged $170 trillion worth of assets. They've pledged to align with net zero and low carbon development. And so those types of initiatives are really important and really show movement also from the private sector and that engagement, the power of investment really to help mobilize not just billions or millions of finance, but trillions of dollars in addressing the climate crisis. And then the last piece, last one I want to mention is this Glasgow Declaration on Forests, which is another announcement from the conference with more than 100 countries, and I didn't include on the slide, but quite a bit of philanthropy money as well, really a pledge to halt and reverse deforestation over the coming decade. And so we see many of these announcements between countries, sort of this voluntary cooperation between countries coming together to work on these elements of the climate crisis. I wanted to mention is known as the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance. I think a lot of discussions about addressing climate change have focused on we call sort of demand side policy, sort of reducing the need for fossil fuels or reducing the need for energy, improving energy efficiency. And this is one of the first sort of international cooperation elements into what I think we would call supply side policy, where begin to sort of look at cutting off the supply, reducing the supply of fossil fuels, and sort of addressing fossil fuel consumption at the source. And so the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance is an initiative from Denmark and Costa Rica. And essentially they've come together with some of these other national governments and even some subnational governments to come forward to say, you know, we plan to, there are different sort of levels between the associate members and the core members, but we plan to stop issuing permits for oil and gas development, or we plan to curtail production of fossil fuels in our countries and in our states, these are some of the other efforts. Another effort on sort of the international cooperation that's come forward to address tackling fossil fuels sort of head on in that way. Just a few, I wanted to end here with a list of a few other ways to engage and support international climate action and international climate cooperation. Certainly the UN climate process is very much focused on national governments, and the Paris Agreement the framework is set up around national governments setting plans and achieving those. So certainly supporting and engaging in domestic policy making is incredibly important. In the US, for example, the Build Back Better initiative from President Biden would go a long way. And I think some analyses have shown is really necessary to ensure that the US would meet its international pledges. And so that's an important way to really support the international cooperation is domestically. The UN also hosts what's known as the Global Climate Action Portal, which is a web portal which is a list, which lists, which is a large database and map of different actions, efforts, initiatives, targets from local governments, of national governments, businesses, all types of different stakeholders, communities. And so it's a really great database of the different pieces that are coming together, different climate actions. And it's a great way to learn from other initiatives or other efforts. And so certainly contributing your own actions, adding to the portal, to that database, is a great way to share your efforts and share efforts of your community and help communicate about those, but also learn from others. And so that's a really useful, useful resource. The UN also sponsors this Race to Zero campaign, which is a campaign for subnational governments, local governments, communities, businesses, all types of different stakeholders to really commit that they themselves will work towards net zero emissions. And so the UN hosts this campaign and is really trying to think about all of the different actors globally moving towards net zero. I will mention is the Science-Based Targets Initiative, which is an initiative for companies, for the private sector, to set targets to reduce their own emissions and through their operations, their suppliers, all of their operations, their product development, et cetera. And the initiative companies put forward a plan, and the initiative gives that a review and checks to make sure that those emissions reductions are in line with the science required to reach 1.5 degrees. And the last piece I'll mention is an initiative that currently isn't picked up within the UN. Is a bit of a different, is a similar idea, I think, in some ways to the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance, is the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty, where it's the same objective to move beyond use of oil and gas and fossil fuels. And so whereas the alliance I previously mentioned was this voluntary collection of countries coming together, this is an effort that's being led to really think about how can we internationally, globally, collectively, all sign on to a new treaty that's that would think about moving beyond fossil fuels. So I think I have taken probably 8 minutes more than I anticipated. Apologies for that, certainly use the rest of the time and any extra time to answer any questions or discuss whatever is top of mind. So let me stop there. I will take down my screens so you can we can have a more useful discussion. But thanks. I hope that was helpful and interesting, but look forward to hearing your questions.
Well, thank you, Nathan. That was wonderful, and it was comprehensive, which is really important at this point in time. So really appreciate it. What I'd like to do is, Terry has been tracking people's questions, but if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll get to you. Terry, if you don't have anything, I'd like to ask a simple question, which is, this month and next month, we've got two more pieces of the IPCC report dropping. And I guess my question is, how is that going to impact because right now it looks like they're going to be fairly severe. How is that going to impact cooperation?
Thanks. That's a good question. And I think it's really important to note that I think the IPCC reports, have been an important and influential component of sort of the international cooperation on climate change, always providing sort of the best and most recent available science. So as you mentioned, we have a new report at the end of this month on the impacts of climate change. And then I think it is, yes, March, maybe the next report on efforts to mitigate it and some of the solutions on climate change. And so these reports certainly will shape future conversations between countries. I think these reports further highlight the need for urgent action. Really, I think the question for countries and for the process is how it takes this information, how it takes these messages, and it's able to act on them urgently and implement policies that both reduce emissions, but also can effectively adapt to climate change. And so I don't know, I think, for many countries, I think especially many of the small island states, the small island countries, for example, speak about, these reports and the importance of them in communicating and outlining sort of the future, they have. And so, they will be important drivers for countries to act upon and act with increased haste.
Do you think that countries actually paid attention to the August IPCC report? Because it certainly didn't seem like COP26 was, people were paying attention to that. I'm sorry, I'm kind of negative on the willingness that countries have to take action. Terry, what do you got? You got questions?
Yeah, I see a hand raised. There was a question in the chat box that was submitted, and it says, Nathan, Greta Thunberg summarized COP26 with blah, blah, blah. So the question is, do you feel we are making real progress, or is it just a lot of talk? Because it's asking for your personal opinion as an observer.
Yeah, it's a great question. I think I always find myself a bit of an optimist. So I always like to think that that we are making progress. But I think, and Greta speaking about the COP and these conferences, I think there's increasingly, seemingly, a potential disconnect between you have negotiators who are in a room fighting over commas and words and language, but I think the public is very starved to see the emissions levels drop, to see concrete action on the ground, to see deployment of renewable energy, to see the electrification of vehicles, for example, as another example. I mentioned this, I think there is this element of sort of these two truths that there's a lot more to do. And some levels, some of the elements are blah, 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 where you're maybe thinking about nice words, but you're not, governments may not be implementing them, projects that sort of speak to that. But at the other hand, I do think there has been value in the work and the efforts that have already been undertaken. So I take Greta's point, and I agree in part, but I do also see a bit of progress.
So, John, there's a question from David.
Nathan, thank you very much for that that summary. It was really good. I'm with SREG and with the Clean Cooking Task Force. So, we're we're trying to make an impact by having roughly 750 million odd open cooking stoves around the world, convert to something that's cleaner, and ideally it's solar. My question, I don't know if you can answer it or not, but you talked a lot about money, $100 billion a year pledged in Kyoto, and then even more, $170 trillion private assets to align with net zero. So one of the really frustrating things that we see with what we're trying to do is to get the funds to do the work that needs to be done. So how do small NGOs access any of that? What steps can we take? Because it seems to be we have Rotary grants, but that's beyond that. That's what I'm, you know, all this money that's out there. How do we do that?
It's a great question. I think in terms of finance, I think and the international discussion on finance, I think they're beyond just the quantity of finance and having enough finance and money moving in the right direction. I think there are questions about both access and sort of the quality of finance. So I'm thinking in terms of a local government, maybe in a developing country, for example, being able to access funding from the international institutions, from the multilateral development banks, and ensuring that finance goes to the local level and you know, is used for community projects. And it's an issue globally. It's an issue that a lot of institutions have struggled with, and so there's certainly a lot of area for improvement there. And then also I wanted, you know, on in terms of public finance, different countries offer, you know, pledge money, offer money to address climate change. You know, some of it is in the form of grants, and some of it is in the form of loans. Different countries approach this differently. So for some small countries, developing countries, you know, you'd much rather have a grant to build your solar farm than you would a loan. And so this is a real issue as well for some of those countries, some of those communities trying to have the finance, but also, you know, not just get stuck in cycles of debt. And there are challenges also for, you know, maybe loan for a solar farm is okay, but a loan for an adaptation project, which may not generate revenue in and of itself, but protects the community, is a different challenge. And so, even for, countries, this is a major challenge. And also, for NGOs, as you mentioned, it's a challenge to be able to access funding, especially from governments, from philanthropy even. And I don't know the right solution fully, but it's something that needs to be addressed and is an evolving work of progress. I hope that's maybe not directly responsive to your question, but a little bit helpful.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Terry?
Not in the chat box. Well, possibly. Let me scroll down here. But I have a question possibly for Nathan. Nathan, on an international front, who do you see as the leaders? Where can people look? Which countries for inspiration? They're sort of setting the pace, or that hopefully will emerge in future COPs as an example of what other countries ought to be doing.
It's a great question. I think the Europeans in some way have been very, very active and have really set quite ambitious goals, and in some ways are now following that up with I think an impressive suite of some domestic policy. I think there's more to be more work to be done in the European Union, but often I think from the developed countryside, the Europeans and the Nordics, I think are usually very proactive and usually constructive and offer some lessons and examples. I think we've also seen a lot from, for example, Costa Rica in the past has been quite active and has some very interesting and exciting, I think, projects. They're one of the key countries of the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance I mentioned. There's others, I think some of the reforms coming out of Chile in the last few months, few years present some interesting examples and lessons. And so there's a wide range of examples and lessons to pick from. But maybe I start with those. I see a few more hands and a few more chats questions. So.
Yeah, Michelle.
Yeah, good morning, Michel Devrin from ESRAC in East Asia. Natian, I don't know if you know about, if you heard anything about ecocide, the crime against, you know, environmental destruction. It's something that we're discussing about recurrence in many countries to raise the awareness because people don't know about this. This was initiated by Pauline Higgins, who unfortunately died 2 years ago as a Scottish lawyer. And she spent, I guess, 10 last years of her life to bring that to the ICC, the International Court for Arbitration, to bring, you know, because it's massive crimes by big corporations, and they're not punished. I mean, CEOs get away with big bonus. If you make them accountable, everything will change. And so what the ecocide is asking every country and every district to speak to your local government and to make them aware and bring that attention, because I think a lot of people are not aware of that. So what is your view on that?
Yes, it's a great question and an important point. I think one of the challenges with the current international system in some ways is the limits of the accountability there. And so I think we see some, you know, certainly though, you know, the UN climate system is a consensus-based process, which means you require all countries on board. And so some of the efforts to for greater accountability or sort of sanctions or penalties, for example, you know, obviously meet resistance in that space. And so it's an important question on, you know, and I know there are efforts, as you mentioned, to bring to the International Criminal Court, international, some of these other mechanisms, and I'm not as familiar with them outside of the UN climate space. I think the question that raises is, how national governments, you know, submit to participate in these systems where they are held responsible for the damages and the crime, you know, the crimes they may be found to have commit. And so it's a question that I think is very useful and one that is not my expertise, but I think is worth further exploring. And we've seen the last few years really also an explosion of, I think, climate litigation, both from, I mean, especially I think in many domestic contexts, citizens, youth, especially, you know, initiating legal action against their governments for failure to protect the atmosphere, the climate for future generations. And so there have been some innovative, so that's a sort of, I think, a new and emerging and innovative field. The rulings in the Netherlands, for example, that have implications for Royal Dutch Shell and its operations. And there have been other cases in France, I believe, found that the French policies were insufficient. And so the French government was ordered by the courts to come forward with new efforts. And so there's really been a number of sort of, I think, a growth in this space. There are several high profile cases pending in the United States as well. And so there are a number of sort of pieces moving in that direction. I think sort of the international criminal courts and the international accountability pieces, I think, among countries becomes a bit more difficult because of the politics and the hesitancy from many countries to engage in some of those processes where true accountability may be delivered is poses a challenge in that space. But it's I think one that will continue to grow. And at the conference in Glasgow, for example, I don't remember which nation. I think there was a Caribbean and a nation from the Pacific Islands announced they would be seeking sort of international criminal opinions on what we've referred to as loss and damage, where because of climate impacts, they lose their land or they are no longer able to farm or some of those types of impacts. And so, you know, they will be seeking to move pieces through the international legal system where they can. So I think there's a lot to look forward to and watch in that space as well.
Thank you. I just to comment on that, Nathan, thank you very much for that insight. Italy is just bringing that move to the government in Italy to bring ecocide into the law, and also a mind shift to say, because we've been measuring for the last 200 years only economic activity, but what is, you know, to bring that the government is there also to serve nature and not only nature. So it's kind of a mind shift, and Italy is going to ratify that. So it's quite positive. Thank you.
Nathan, thank you very much for everything that you presented and for being here with us.